Welcome to Park Hill Christian Church Worship. No matter where you are or when you're watching, we're so glad you chose to worship with us. Come, now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship, just as you are before your God. Come.
Prepare your hearts and minds for communion this morning. I'd like for you to reflect on what Paul asked the church in Philippi. He said, "Come with the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Come as a servant, humble, obedient to death. Come without grumbling or arguing so that you may be blameless and pure children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Come shining like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life." I invite you all to come to the table.
This will I do, my Lord, in glory. Please bow your head and pray with me. Precious Father, we each come before you today with different concerns and burdens in our hearts and on our minds. Yet despite all the challenges that life brings, we're also so very blessed. We are blessed because we serve a God who loves us so much without expectation of anything in return. We thank you for the gift of your Son who loved us all the way to the cross. We ask your blessing on each emblem we hold in our hands today, representing your broken body and your spilled blood. And we thank you for your gift of eternal life, a gift that all we have to do is accept. Help us to see our lives through the lens of your cross. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread and blessed it and broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim his death until he comes again."
Good morning, boys and girls. Last week's Sunday school lesson was about how Jesus took the 5 loaves and 2 fishes given to him and the disciples by a little boy, and he fed nearly 10,000 people. I want you to think about the word sufficient. Because Jesus took that little bit of bread and that little bit of food, fish, and he multiplied it to where it was sufficient for everyone to not only eat all they wanted, but even to have a little extra. We just moved to a new house, and I'd like to tell you that our boxes multiplied like Jesus multiplied the loaves and the fishes, but all of this stuff is my doing. God knows exactly what we need. He gives us what is sufficient. He loves us, and he knows our hearts. Talk to your families about the word sufficient this week, and see if you can't see how anything you've given God, he has multiplied to be sufficient for your needs. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we love you, but we love these boys and girls. We miss their faces and the faces of their families, but we are praying for them, Lord, every day, and we know that they are growing strong in their faith and their love of you, Jesus Christ. Let them know how sufficient you are, Lord, because you meet their every need. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I am weak, I am old.
As we prepare to go to God in prayer, gather your concerns and the people you love in your heart, and let's lift them all up together. Almighty, sovereign God, we come before you humbled at your feet. Let this prayer be heard not just in the words taught to us by our mothers and fathers, but also in the words taught to us by your Holy Spirit. We step out in faith, lacking wisdom and experience, Lord, but with the full understanding that your will must be done. Lord, we lift up to you this morning our friends, family, community, and nation. You are hearing similar prayers from believers all around the world. We pray that you hear our call from this desert, just as you heard your children as they called from that Egyptian desert, Lord, suffering at the cruel hands of their captors. We too seek your healing, your comfort, your wisdom, your redemption, and your loving arms. For this church, Lord, we seek to be unified in our love for you and in your holy word made flesh, your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, ignite in us a spirit that will wake us up. Open our eyes as you opened Paul's. Let us see the needs of your people and let us know how to respond. Let us see ourselves as members of your flock, part of a Christian community that spans races, cultures, and continents. Lord, forgive us when we separate ourselves and elevate ourselves above others. Show us the pain we cause when we do these things. Tell us when we become a stumbling block for others, that by our poor behavior we block and mock the world's view of your Son and your holy kingdom. Redirect us, Lord. Open our hearts and ears that we may know your reprimand and seek your correction. Lord, help us to keep our feet on your path, but most humbly, Lord, we ask that the indwelling of the Holy Spirit shines so brightly in each of us that we become signposts directing the lost to your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask all of this in your name and in the name of your Son, Jesus. Hear us, Lord, as we say together your Son's holy prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Be a sweet, sweet sound.
When I look back upon the life of Jesus, I see a man who was focused on daily living. He created no organization, no administration, no system. He personally left no written plan. As a matter of fact, as far as we know, Jesus left no writing at all. If you think about it, it's us, the church, who've over time determined what type of people Jesus is concerned about. The ones he loves and will save. We've made Jesus the fierce judge and also the gentle lamb. Over the centuries, people have forced Jesus into one category or another. He's black, he's brown, he's white, he's a Democrat, he's a Republican. You get the idea. When this happens, and it always happens, we lose a very important aspect of exactly who Jesus is. We lose his freedom to encounter and love everyone. If you would, hear these words from the 8th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. When Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately, he was cleansed of his leprosy. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus is a man who meets people, women, men, and children. He encounters them as they are, where they are. Unlike us, Jesus doesn't see kinds of people. He doesn't seem to care much about categories like some of us do. He doesn't migrate or avoid people based upon their skin color, their gender, wealth, age, education, or nationality. None of these categories, which can be important to some of us, seem to mean much of anything to Jesus. Jesus seems to take people as he finds them, and he offers himself. He doesn't force himself on people. He doesn't try to manipulate. He simply and fully offers himself. Looking at the story of Mary and Martha, where Martha is busy in the kitchen and Mary is listening to Jesus teach, he doesn't see the women as forever destined to be one way or another. I don't think he sees Mary as a Mary, contemplative, serene, and eternally sitting at his feet. I also don't think he sees Martha as a Martha, hustling about, self-absorbed, and upset about having to do everything herself. Jesus comes into their home, and he offers himself to them. One is too busy, too caught up in the work, too worried about what she has to do to take advantage of the opportunity he has created her by coming into her home. Mary takes advantage of the opportunity. She stops and comes to sit, listen, and learn. Martha's caught up in the traditional role of dutiful hostess, the role society says that she's supposed to play. She doesn't see the opportunity that Jesus is offering to break free of that stereotypical role. Mary, on the other hand, sees that now is the time to break away from that role, to do what only men are allowed to do, to sit with the Lord and learn. And what about the story of the Good Samaritan? In that story, three people are presented with an opportunity in the form of a beaten, half-naked man lying in a ditch, almost dead. Two of them, the priest and the Levite man, walk on past. They see it, but they go to the other side of the road, and they continue on their way. The third one takes advantage of the opportunity. The Samaritan sees the man and gives in to the great compassion that the sight brings to his heart. He stops, cares for, and even pays for the injured man. After the story, Jesus tells the lawyer who wanted to know how to obtain eternal life, go and do likewise. In the story of the rich ruler, there lies yet another opportunity to take advantage of Jesus' presence. The ruler, just like the lawyer, asks how he might inherit eternal life. He's told to follow all the commandments, and the ruler says he already does. Jesus then says, go and sell all you have and give the proceeds to the poor, and then come and follow me. But the ruler lets his wealth get in the way. He walks away, rejecting Jesus. Jesus offers opportunity. Some accept and some don't. That's just the way it is. But Jesus doesn't order the people he meets to obey him or else. He doesn't condemn those who don't accept his offering. I imagine he was pretty sad, just as Martha must have been when he rebuked her for being so upset at Mary. And when that ruler turned and walked away from Jesus, I imagine Jesus experienced deep sadness, not eternal condemnation. The Bible never hints that the ruler, the priest, the Levite, or even Martha were ever cut off. It doesn't state that it was their last opportunity. I mean, certainly Martha will have another chance to sit and listen, a day when she's able to see and take advantage of the opportunity that's before her. Hopefully the wealthy ruler will hear Jesus's agonizing death and hear of his amazing resurrection and turn fully toward him, shedding his wealth so he can follow Jesus. And how do we know that the Levite and the priest didn't on another occasion stop and care for someone else? If Jesus dealt with us as types, there would be no second chances. Let me say that again. If Jesus dealt with us as types, there would be no second chances. If all Marthas were shut out, if all Levites and priests were doomed to just walk on by, if all the wealthy people in this world were wrapped up in that one young ruler, there'd be no hope, no opportunity for grace to change their lives. But thank God that's not how Jesus operates. He offers himself to the serene and the busy, the compassionate and the distracted, the wealthy and the poor. I want to share with you a poem by poet Greta Zwan titled, I'm Learning. When you see me, don't be alarmed. I'm not a finished project. A work in making just begun, no longer known as reject. Many changes must be made, many plans to alter. Efforts to reclaim the mold are bound to often falter. Restoration will take time. The work God's undertaken, the mighty master of the clay, will not leave me forsaken. I'm pliable and need to learn. My spirit must be willing. God will not force his choice on me. He's lovingly instilling. New thoughts to form within my heart, ideas that will inspire to make me more like his dear son and give me that desire. That all my plans fit into his will as each day dawns before me. I find the guidance in his word in case sin should allure me. My safety lies within his love, my heart within his will. I need to listen to his voice. He's whispering, peace, be still. Jesus meets each of us where we're at in any particular moment in our lives. He knows exactly what we need from him. We may need the peace of heart and spirit to simply sit and absorb. We may need to go out into the ditches of this world and do likewise. We may need to rid ourselves of some of our possessions that come between us and our God. This is the part of Jesus's love for us all. He knows us completely, but he still loves us. He meets us as individuals created by his Father, not as types. He meets us where we are, and by his presence, he offers to make our lives richer, whole, fulfilled. An old sailor kept getting lost at sea, so his friend gave him a compass, and he urged him to actually use it. The next time he went out on his boat, he took the compass with him, but as usual, he became hopelessly confused and was unable to find land. Finally, he was rescued by his friend. Disgusted and impatient with him, he asked, "Why didn't you use that compass I gave you? This would have saved both of us a lot of trouble." The sailor responded, "I didn't dare use it. I wanted to go north, but as hard as I could try to make that needle point north, it just kept on pointing southeast." You see, the old sailor was so certain that he knew which way was north, that he stubbornly tried to force his own personal persuasion on a compass. Unable to do so, he tossed it aside as useless, worthless, and failed to benefit from the guidance the compass offered. Friends, this is exactly what I'm talking about. Jesus offers himself, but it's up to us to seize the opportunity. "Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean." "I am willing," Jesus said. "Be clean." Friends, the Lord is always, always willing. It's us I'm worried about. My prayer today is that we'll constantly remember that he loves each and every one of us, and that we'll keep ourselves open to encountering him over and over again every day of our lives. Amen.